present his her paper, and her paper is on Charvak ethics and its and its relevance in present day time. It may not be the exact title, but the implication of the title is this: the Charvak ethics and its necessity in our day-to-day life. So she will compare Charvak ethics, whether it is any relevance for our day-to-day life in the present day society. So now I welcome Mrs. Sarangi to present her paper. Thank you.
Hello, am I audible to all of you? Hello?
Yes, audible, audible, madam. Audible.
You are audible.
Namaskar, sir, and good afternoon, all esteemed chairperson of today's session, Dr. Sachindra Raul, sir, former associate professor in philosophy and the registrar, Utkal University of Culture, Bhubaneswar, Odisha. My revered teacher, Professor Ganesh Prasad Das, sir. Respected principal, Srimati Vinita Manjari Raut, madam. Coordinator, Dr. Kailash Chandra Maharana, sir. Other respected dignitaries and senior teachers of philosophy, Dhaneshwar, sir. Vasant Kumar Das, sir. Kailash, sir. Durga Madhav Prahara, sir, and others who are present in this digital platform. My co-speaker of today's session, Pramod Kumar Das, sir, and my dear student friends. First of all, I congratulate the department Balugarh College and Principal Madam for organizing this national webinar on Indian philosophy and practical life, which is sponsored by Indian Council of Philosophical Research. I am very much grateful to Professor Ganesh Prasad Das, sir, for helping me in framing this title for today's presentation. I am also thankful to all of you for giving me this opportunity to share my ideas with you and to learn from you as well. The title of my paper is Charvak Ethics and Life at Present. Okay. Indian culture and philosophical tradition is the witness of different worldviews, as we all know that every philosophical endeavor begins with a worldview. Different philosophical systems, therefore, logically presuppose that there are different worldviews, paradigms, or alternative models of thought, and there are also paradigm shifts. Indian classical materialism is the chief representative of one such paradigm, which is otherwise known as Charvak Darshan. Regarding the etymological meaning of Charvak, we see that there are different interpretations. Some say that the word Charvak is a compound word consisting of two simple words, charu and baka. Charu means sweet and baka means speech. Those who speak sweetly, they are called charvakas. Still others maintain that charvayante punya papadikam vastu jatam iti charvakah. Here, charvayanti means bhakhyayanti, eating up or chewing up. Hence, those who eat up their own words, eat up all moral and ethical considerations without making any distinction, are called as charvakas. To quote Madhvacharya from Sarva Darshana Sangraha, where he says, javat jivet sukham jivet runam krutva grutam pivet asmi rudasya dehasya punaragamanah kruta. I repeat it. Javat jivet sukham jivet runam krutva grutam pivet asmi rudasya dehasya punaragamanah kruta. The very tendency or the general psychology of human being is to seek pleasure and shun pain. therefore as long as you live happily, eat, drink and be merry should be the motto of human life. This is also called as Lokayata Darsana, as it is the philosophy of us or the common people. People are comfortable with general people, I mean us people. Similarly, regarding the founder of this system, we see that there are different views. One view says that there was a sage named Charvaka, while other view states that Charvaka is not a proper name, but a common name. Still others hold that Brihaspati is said to be the founder of Charvaka. However, in Indian philosophical tradition, we have two traditions, namely Astika and Nastika. Charvaka is named as Nastika Shiromani. Ordinarily, Nastika refers to the people who do not believe in the existence of God, and Astika as the believer in the existence of God. But it has a different connotation in philosophy. The very word Nastika originates from the Sanskrit word nasti. Panini, the Sanskrit grammarian, explains the words as asti nasti vishtam mati. In other words, Nastika is a person who does not believe in other world. Manu in his Manusmriti said, Nastika ho Vedaninda ka. For him, Nastika is a person who does not believe in the authority of the Veda. Therefore, Charvaka Darshan is called as Darshan. Out of these two definitions of Nastika, Manu's definition is more acceptable because it includes other world within its fold. We find the references of Charvaka in the epics of Ramayana, Javali Rishi, and in the Mahabharata, while Yudhishthira was severed and he was accepted as the king, in the Kamasutra of Vatsayana, and in the Arthashastra of Kautilya, and in the Bhagavad Gita as well. In the chapter 2, verse 32 of the Gita, it is said that Yam Imam Puspitam Vacham Pravadanti Abhipaschitah. That means people get attracted. I just give importance on two words, that is Puspitam Vacham, which again emphasizes that people get attracted towards flowery words. With these general features, let me begin with Charvaka ethics. As you all know, ethics of a system is guided by its metaphysical framework. Therefore, it becomes pertinent to discuss the metaphysical outlook of this system. Here, metaphysics does not mean beyond this physical world. Rather, it refers to the theory of reality. Very, very briefly, I can say that they do not believe in Pancha Mahabhuta. Rather, they believe in Chatvari Bhuta, four realities. They believe only in four physical elements, namely earth, water, fire, and air. They do not believe in ether, as it is not subject to pratyaksha pramana. Rather, they believe in, we can interpret in this way, that the ether is certain, plus they give importance on the four gross elements, therefore they rejected ether. They are also called as Swabhavavadi and Jadruchavadi, accidentalism, and their system is called accidentalism and naturalism. No teleology, no purpose is required. The different combinations of elements in different proportions give rise to different products. Tat samudaya sarire indriya vishaya sanya. The ethical principles are the natural outcome of this metaphysical. Principles of Charvaka are as Charvaka regards pleasure, mainly sensuous pleasure as the summum bonum of human life. Present life is the only life that we get. Once the body is reduced to ashes, there is no hope of coming back here again. Therefore, it is wise to make the best use of this present life by accumulating as much pleasure as we can. Much later, Kabir, the mystic poet, substantiated this in his doha that jo kal kare so aaj, jo aaj kare so ab, parme parlay hoegi, bahuri karegi kab. Present life should not be sacrificed for the sake of future life. Who will give us the guarantee that a good life is awaiting for us in future? Future is highly unpredictable and uncertain. Is it not the foolishness of one to sacrifice a bird at hand in order to get hundreds in the bush? It is also advised that we should not waste our present moments in brooding over the past. Past is already gone and future is highly uncertain, so live in the present to the fullest. Further, pleasure is always found to be associated with pain. On account of this, one should not run away from seeking pleasure. But the wise man does not reject corn because of the husk. No one gives up eating fish because there are bones and scales in the fish. Yes, we agree that there are problems in our lives. By admitting pain and problems with lives, admitting pain with pleasure, Charvak encouraged us not to be bogged down by the presence of pain, rather face them with challenges. Charvak also gave importance or utmost importance to the physical health or physical well-being. This is also more pertinent in the present COVID-19 pandemic. We all want good immunity, insulated body. This physical body is essential for any further activity. Kalidasa, in his Kumara Sambhavam, also said that Sariram Adyam Haldharma Sadhanam. Charvak also denies life after death. They admit only this life as it is subject to Pratyaksha Pramana. Life begins with birth and ends with death. For them, death is liberation. There is no soul apart from the body. Soul is nothing but the conscious body, Dehatma Vadi. They admit consciousness, but they do not admit consciousness independent of the body. Consciousness is a byproduct, an epiphenomenon, an important property. Matter creates mind as liver creates body. Hence, different concepts which are usually associated with immortality of soul, like law of karma, merit, demerit, heaven, hell, rebirth, liberation, etc., are completely denied. They understood heaven as pleasure associated with body. Life with pleasure is called heaven or swarga for them, and life with pain is called. They do not believe in any supernatural power or Ishwar. They rejected the existence of God by using the simple principle of epistemology. God is not subjected to direct experience. Therefore, they rejected it, Ishwarabada. They are against all forms of rites, rituals, ceremonies, and sacrifices, as these are the beautiful arrangements made by the cunning priests for their livelihood. There are beautiful lines to support it. If a beast is slain in the Jyotishtama rite, will go to heaven, why not the sacrificer offer his own father? If offerings are given to the departed beings in in the form of shraddhas here, then why not give the food down below to those who are standing on the housetop? Why we make provisions of food for the family members who are traveling? Let's serve the food in the dining table, on the dining table, and the person who is traveling collect his amount of food. So further, you know, in Indian tradition, we regard four ends of human life, that is called the purusharthas. We admit four purusharthas: dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Kama, according to Charvaka, is the end of human life, and artha is the means to fulfill this end. Here, kama is not used in the narrow sense of lust. Rather, it is used in the sense of kamana or desire. This is the, you can say that this is the viewpoint of Dhruta or crude Charvakas, mostly led by Madhavacharya. But the followers of Sushikita or cultured Charvakas includes dharma along with artha and kama. Artha and kama has to be regularized by dharma. Admission of dharma makes them no more crude and gross, rather makes room for qualitative pleasure over quantitative one, just like that of Epicurus of Greek philosophy. In the present society, I'm just coming to my concluding part. In the present society, no doubt, we see the presence of all types of Charvakas. Broadly, we divide Charvakas into threefold: Daitantika, prominent follower of Daitantika is Jayarasi Bhatta. They are, you can say that radical Charvakas or extreme form of Charvakas. And then we talk about Dhruta or crude Charvakas. And Madhavacharya is a follower of that crude form. And then we talk about Sushikita or cultured Charvakas, Purandara, or you can say Akshayana. They are the follower of this form of Charvakas. We find all the forms of Charvakas even in the present society. Anybody is in position and power, immediately fill his pocket with food. They just live for themselves at the cost of others. There are also other groups. There are also human beings we find in the present society who believes in the meaningful living by believing in charity, compassion, helping others. They do not sacrifice their own pleasure, but at the same time, they look after the pleasure of others. They are concerned of others. A qualitative living is definitely more meaningful than a mere living. Vatsayana said that pleasure should be sought in conformity with dharma. To conclude, I can say that Charvaka Darsana is more misunderstood than understood. It is marginalized in the domain of Indian philosophy. It has its own place, it has its own fragrance and own values. We cannot simply reject it by saying that it is crude, egoistic hedonism, and believe in only one pramana, that is the pratyaksha pramana. Vatsayana perspective definitely is to be reinterpreted and re-understood. Cultured Charvakas, by admitting dharma along with artha and kama, makes room for moral choices. It is positive and as well as pragmatic, and the positive contributions of Charvaka Darshan to the society is that they advise not to depend on others' words. We should use our own intelligence. They promote agriculture, trade, participation in the polity, that is also required for the smooth functioning of the society. They reject or they discourage people not to believe in blind beliefs. rather promote to rely on your own experience. That is the reason for which we say them to be the lokayatika, lokayata, because loka means experience and lokesu ayata iti lokayata. And their positive contribution is that we must earn, we must learn to enjoy our enjoy this life, though there is, it is always associated with pain. Rather, we have to ignore pain and we have to focus more on pleasure, and we have to live in conformity with dharma, artha and kama. These are the positive contributions. That's why we can say them to be positive as well as pragmatic, because they give importance on the practical consequences of each and every of our actions. Actions, if there is excess of pain over pleasure, then that is a wrong action. If there is excess of pleasure over pain, then that is a good action. So to conclude, I can say that the Charvak Darshan made a great effort to check the dogmatic attitude of the Indian philosophical system to a great extent. It encourages the spirit of free thinking and not to accept anything out of reverence for the time honored tradition unless it is scrutinized with logical reasoning. It encourages to do constructive speculation by being analytical and critical. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. I cut it short so that we can have more discussions. Here I want to confess one thing. Yesterday I had only came to, I think, know about a very good book written by Dhaneshwar sir on Charvak Darshan, and I wish I could have gone through this paper, but as Dhaneshwar sir is here, I definitely wish a very constructive discussion so that we all can be benefited. Thank you and namaskar to all of you for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Kalyani, for your nice presentation. I should say you have taken a very positive positive constructive approach towards Charvak philosophy. As we know, Charvak philosophy has been degraded. If we come across any common popular Indian philosophical text, we will find that Charvak philosophy has been expressed in very derogative terms, that it is sensualism, it is individualistic hedonism, and it doesn't believe in any super kind of things. So it's a very low type of attitude and thought they promote. So like this, the other group, the Vedantic groups, they have downgraded Charvak thought. So that is found in most philosophical texts, but we do not have much access to the original writings. So original writings may not be available, but what we can say, the primitive ancient writings on Charvak philosophy, so I don't have any access. So as I know, Professor Dhaneshwar Sahu has translated the Lokayat of D.P. Chattopadhyay, not this D.P. Chattopadhyay who is living, but the some other D.P. Chattopadhyay, who was a man of 19th century, and his book Lokayat has been translated by Professor Sahu. Neither I have read the book of Lokayat of Dipu Chattopadhyay, nor I have gone through the Oriya translation of Professor Sahu. So I think he is the only expert to put Charvak in the right perspective. Whether he is to be degraded, downgraded, it has been done by the philosophical or there is some constructive positive approach in his philosophy. As Kalyani has pointed out, I agree with her that he has taken a right stand and he has grouped the Charvakas into three categories, something like crude and cultured. And so the cultured Charvakas, they include dharma and artha, and dharma is the binding principle, but kama is not the sole motto of human life. So this kind of presentation really
Sir, have you any technical problem? Sir, have you any technical problem? You are not audible. Sir, Sachi sir, you are not audible. Have you any technical problem? Hello, Sachi sir. What to do? Hello? Kalyani, Doctor? Kalyani?
Okay.
Do listen to Professor Rao?
No. He's not audible.
Perhaps actually he has faced some technical problem. Okay. Then what to do? Actually, we can invite question queries or observations from the participants, because Professor Rahul has left the meeting. Perhaps he has faced some technical problem. Okay, please ask any question or observation so that Dr. Kalyani Sarangi is with us. She will answer your questions or queries. If anybody has any question or queries or observation, please directly unmute and then ask question. Okay, Dhaneshwar sir, would you like to speak something? Have you any observation on the talk of Dr. Kalyani?
Actually, I am waiting for Dhaneshwar sir's observation.
Am I audible?
Yes,
am
sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Achha. I very much thank Kalyani madam as well as Suchindra Babu. Actually, I have not translated D.P. Chattopadhyay's book on Lokayat. I have used his book to a large extent in writing a book, Bharatiya Darshanare Nirishwarabad. Ye gote bahi mor. My second book is Bharatiya Manasa Ishwarabad Banam Nirishwarabad, published by A.K. Mishra. Actually, three books have been authored by D.P. Chattopadhyay. One is What is Living and What is Dead in Indian Philosophy. Second book is Lokayat. Third book is Atheism in Indian Philosophy. When I read these books, I learned a lot of things and my understanding of Indian philosophy took a different turn as I had read Datta Chatterjee or C.D. Sharma or Hiriyana. So Professor D.P. Chattopadhyay has presented a philosophy of Charvak quite from a rational and perspective which touched me most. Then I read a second book that is written by Vedaprakash Barma. He has also written a very authoritative book on Indian philosophical system and highlighting the Charvak philosophy to its in a very positive and constructive way. And then I can also cite the book Professor Bijayananda Kara has written on philosophy of Charvak, and that is also a very interesting book where Professor Bijayananda Kara has presented the Charvak philosophy from the epistemological point of perspective, from the metaphysical, from ethical, from axiological, from all perspectives. So when I read all these books, I was greatly inspired to write a book on Nirishwarvada, atheism in Indian philosophy. That is one dimension. And the second thing is, all the works of Charvak have been destroyed in the tradition. Not a single work is found. And Charvak was pre-Buddhistic. 2000 years of Charvak's death, or when Charvak philosophy was popular, it was Madhavacharya, who was a Vedantin, and he for the first time tried to present in a systematic way what might be the philosophical views of Charvak. Because no literature is left, there is nothing of the Charvak's writings, then he, for the first time, Madhavacharya constructed what might be the philosophical system of Charvak, taking the criticisms of Charvak from the other philosophical systems. When Vedanta or Anyaya or Vaisheshika, even Buddhism, they criticize Charvak, they take the some weak points, but the positive points have not been highlighted. And since there is no writing on Charvak, and it was Madhavacharya who for the first time wrote a systematic work on Charvak, all authors on Indian philosophy relied on Madhavacharya's writings. But I thank Kalyani for very systematically presenting the views of Charvak in a nutshell, which seems to be very interesting. And there is also another book on Charvak epistemology. Mr. Arthapran Tripathi has written a book, Charvak Epistemology. So in this way, many new literature have developed in the meanwhile, and those who present Charvak philosophy in a right perspective. I thank Madam Kalyani for making a distinction between the radical Charvak, crude Charvak, and a cultured Charvak. And a cultured Charvak perhaps is the real view, might be the real view of Charvak. They were not sensualist, they were rather in the language of John Stuart Mill or Bentham, we can say they are hedonist, but hedonist not in the crude sense, in a refined hedonism. That is the universal appeal of pleasure, happiness. So all people believe that we want to live happily. Nobody deliberately wants sorrow or suffering. And if at all there is any sorrow or suffering, it can be mitigated by human effort, by human endeavor. So if civilization has progressed, it's because of human endeavor or human attempt. No God or no supernatural power has ever come to the rescue of man to save him. So it may be corona or it may be any other thing in the past, when there it is man only and his knowledge and his perseverance, his effort, which have been helped human civilization to progress. That is the great message that Charvak has given, or Charvak philosophy has given. which is presented by Chattopadhyay, Veda Prakash Varma, and Professor Vijayananda Kara. All these professors who have made extensive research on Charvaka philosophy, they have presented it. So Charvaka philosophy in the new perspective means a humanistic philosophy, a this worldly philosophy, not any other worldly philosophy, but a this worldly philosophy, a humanistic philosophy, a rationalistic philosophy, a philosophy believing that man is the maker of his destiny, man is the maker of his civilization. Thanking you for giving me this opportunity to share some of my ideas on Charvaka. Thanking you all.
Sir, please unmute yourself. Sir, Sathya sir, please unmute yourself. Sathya sir, please unmute yourself.
Thank you. Thank you, Dhaneshwar sir. Now I welcome other participants if they have any query. So, any other question?
Sir, actually, am I audible to you? Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Namaskar,
yes.
Everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Audible. Yes, now it is audible. You are audible.
Yes. Malab, I could listen to certain portions of the lecture given by Dr. Kalyani Sadangi. Very interesting. Actually, it is not an off day today for us. Okay, it is office time, so we have to attend to the duties and have to attend the lecture. But one thing that comes to my mind in this life, things become. In the Charvaka scheme of things, if we restrict everything to this present life, we have certain actions, good actions and bad actions, if they are not answered. Well, many are not answered. So how do we account for that? And we also suffer for certain things which we have not done, which we remember we have not done. We do suffer certain things, say born in a very poor family. How am I responsible for being born in a very poor family? Or somebody is born in a very rich family, that he is born in a rich family. If we restrict everything to this, what we experience, hold only to this life only, so things become difficult. So answering such sort of questions become very difficult, because we are not able to know why a person is born in a very rich house and why somebody is born in a very poor house. And maybe I do certain actions, but I am not rewarded for that. Maybe I die, but I am never rewarded. I do certain actions, I murder, but I am not punished. So how do we account for the entire scheme of things that take place in this life? Well, I admit that we need to take whatever comes to us the way they come, but at the same time, we have certain questions to answer. Unless and until we make a resort to the past life or the future life, maybe. How to account for the beginning and how to account for the end when my consequences are not answered too. I have done a good work, but I am not.
Sir, please, okay. Ask me one after another. I am getting confused. So many questions at the same time.
Okay, Kalyani, will you respond to his questions? Should I add a few words?
Yes, sir.
So if you want to speak, you speak, or else I can answer to one question.
Sir, better you.
So anyway, so Professor Om Narayan Rao has raised a very important question. So in Charvaka's framework, how should we how can we explain the first beginning of my life, so that I am born in a rich family, and how in many times we get consequences of our good actions. So all these things are there. So even if we accept law of karma cannot give any guarantee or cannot give sufficient explanation that why I am born in a rich family. Law of karma, as we interpret, as you sow, so you reap, is simply a metaphysical presupposition. It is a presupposition. You may believe it, you may not believe it. But in rational terms, in scientific terms, we cannot give an explanation by taking law of karma that somebody is born in a rich family according to his prarabdha and somebody born in a poor family. So we cannot give sufficient explanation for that. Even if law of karma cannot give sufficient explanation for that, it is simply a metaphysical presupposition. It's a moral presupposition, which if you believe, then you have an explanation. If you do not believe, then this is not sufficient to give a scientific rational explanation. So Charvakas do not believe in this kind of moral presupposition, that is law of karma. So this is my submission. If anybody has something more to say, then they may give their opinions.
Can I give an explanation? Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Then, look, in Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Zoroastrianism, there is no idea of rebirth. If you read Bertrand Russell's famous essay, for Why I'm Not a Christian, suppose you believe in Christianity or Islam or Judaism or Zoroastrianism, in all these religious orders, no idea of rebirth is there. They found some social injustice. Some people do good work, but they suffer. Some people did bad work, they rise. So, all in Western civilization, they have imagined that there is a hell and there is a heaven. There will be a day of a judgment. God will judge who has done good things. He will be given, sent to the eternal hell or eternal heaven. So if somebody has done good things, he will be sent to the heaven for eternity. If somebody has done bad things, he will be sent to the hell for eternity. But so they try to give an explanation in this way. But in our system, we find that if somebody is born in a difficult situations, in a bad situation, somebody is born as a physically handicapped, we think he did some bad work. And that is the consequence. This is the consequence. And if somebody has done good work, then he will be born in a good family. In order to justify the social discrimination of Indian society, that is Brahminical order, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, if somebody is born as a Shudra or Ati Shudra, it is because he did some bad thing, so he is destined to suffer as an Ati Shudra or as a Shudra. To justify a social evil, this thing has been designed. This is one interpretation. Some people say that Indians thought of rebirth, Indians thought of previous birth only to justify a social evil, a social injustice. If somebody is born as Atishudra or somebody born as a Shudra, it is because of his bad deeds he is caused to suffer. This is one way of looking at things from the sociological point of view. And suppose somebody has done some very good work, a very good doctor is very good, has made many operations and has saved the life of many people. So who is going to get the result? The doctor himself or the society? It is the society. Mahatma Gandhi, we know, did commendable work not only for humanity, but not only for India, for the whole of humanity. Some people say that if Gandhi was killed ultimately, if Indira Gandhi was assassinated ultimately, then might be they have done some bad work in their previous life. So they would they are punished in this way. So many ugly explanations will come. If I do good things, society will rise. If I do bad things, then society will suffer. And my individual goodness leads to social happiness, as social happiness or social prosperity. So from this angle, this problem can be approached. And as Professor Sachindra Babu told very rightly, this is a metaphysical presupposition that there is previous birth, doctrine of karma. So many writings have been there on doctrine of karma, particularly Professor Netrananda Malla, I remember, had published a very interesting article on doctrine of karma in Indian Philosophical Quarterly Journal. And very nicely written all that article, doctrine of karma. And perhaps I have read many other articles on doctrine of karma, how doctrine of karma is that theory is there, prevalent in Indian system, but that theory cannot be rationally established and it has no scientific basis at all. It is just a metaphysical speculation. It is just a metaphysical speculation that we believe to justify an evil in the society. This thing has been presupposed and it has no basis, no rational basis to be justified. So many sociologists, many anthropologists, many psychologists have also dealt with this problem of karma and how this theory has made Indian life a bad one. And for justifying social evils for generations to come, for centuries to come, people became indifferent to their social evils and social problems. But man can better off his society by his own effort. If there are evils, there are many sufferings in society, it is not because of some past karma. If some societies are developed, advanced, not that all people there have done good things. If maximum people suffer in third world countries like India, they have done bad things in their previous life. So from the sociological perspective, from the psychological perspective, from the anthropological perspective, social evils, social problems, social inequalities can be approached. That is another way of solving the discrimination, discrepancy in social life. This is my humble submission. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, one thing. If we take even the philosophy of Buddha, he was much concerned with this life, but he did not restrict the karma. He did not deny the karma doctrine. He neither restrict the karma doctrine nor even reject the theory of rebirth. He did allow both of them. He was a social philosopher, had a concern for the social issues, was not pondering over the metaphysical issues, but ultimately had found, though he denied the existence of soul, but still, he was much concerned about the law of karma and the doctrine of rebirth. So that's how this theory cannot be denied for the Charvaka sake.
Buddha was living 2500 years back. Had Buddha been living today, perhaps Buddha might have revised his notion. And there is a very famous book written by D.D. Bandiste. The book is Dhamma. And it is a Buddhist interpretation. And I appeal my friends, if anybody wants to read that book, we will get the explanation how he has interpreted karma. Buddha believed in no soul theory. And he had also justified that Buddha did not believe in the theory of karma as it is traditionally interpreted by others. She has presented D.D. Bandiste, professor of philosophy, perhaps living. I don't know. If he is living, then he must be 97 or 98. He has authored a number of books. I have at least 10 books with me, authored by D.D. Bandiste, a professor of philosophy. He has presented a Buddhism in a very interesting manner and a very rational manner. That is, the book is Dhamma. That is, and also Ambedkar has written a book on Buddhism. a 500 or 600 book on Buddhism, and in Ambedkar's book we find a different interpretation of the so-called theory of dharma, karma. So in this way, new theories, new interpretations have been coming, and we cannot say that how Buddhism has been presented by our classical writers or traditional writers, that is the real explanation of Buddhism. Thanking you.
Okay, any other question from any other participant? So, Kailash, Professor Kailash Chandra Das, if you want to speak something. Kailash is there or not, I don't know.
Kailash sir, would you want to?
Yes, yes. So you just speak a few words, then we will conclude this session.
Okay, okay. So for my knowledge is concerned, Charvaka philosophy has its own ethics, but we don't agree with many parts of it, because the whole tradition argument, had there not been Charvaks, then we could not have proudly said that we have an argumentative tradition in India, Indian philosophical tradition. We have differences, we have argued with each other, so it would have been very tasteless in that sense. And number two, yes, is that the Charvakas only when said that they do things like it is popularly said that eat, drink, make merry, tomorrow is uncertain and you may die, that kind of thing is it more propagated. But their basic ethics is not so much highlighted. That is what my, but Kalyani madam has tried to do some justice by highlighting some of the aspects which are there. So this is what my observations, and in Indian philosophy actually the lokayatas are contrasted with the materialist philosophy in the sense of the communistic materialistic philosophy in that sense. So but actually here it is a more and more anti-metaphysical, more and more it is not only Nastic in the sense of Vedanindukaha, but also Nastic in the sense of atheists. They are both atheists, and also they don't accept the authority of the Vedas. So both way, Nastic word applies to them, and a Nastic philosophy was so popular. So this says about the diversity of Indian philosophical systems, and it is a very great remark that it can be said. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Das. So let us conclude this session. So once again, I put emphasis on that issue of law of karma. So as I have understood it, law of karma does not have a scientific basis. It is not a law of causality in the sense of say Newton speaks about law of causality. So somebody doing so many good works may not be properly rewarded in his life, he may suffer. And many bad people also, they do many bad works, there are many instances, but they also pass away without suffering much. And so we can say that law of karma, it is simply a moral presupposition, a metaphysical presupposition, and it does not have a scientific basis. It does not contain the sense of causality as we speak causality in the field of science. So with these words, I thank all the participants, those a very positive approach towards Charvak materialism, and I thank the paper reader Mrs. Sarangi, and who has cited many good philosophers and their contributions towards a very constructive aspect of Charvak system. So with these words, I also thank Professor Kailash Maharana and the principal of the college who have done so much for the success of this seminar. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Okay, thanks so much.
I propose a formal vote of thanks by some of the teachers.
Okay, thanks so much, Sachi sir, for chairing this session. And it's my pride privilege to propose a vote of thanks from the Department of Philosophy, Baluan College. May I now request our faculty member, Prakash Kumar Sethi, to propose formal vote of thanks. Oh, over to Prakash.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon to everyone. Today is the second day of ICPR-sponsored webinar on Indian philosophy and practical life, organized by Department of Philosophy, Baluan College, Khordha, Odisha. Distinguished speakers, Dr. Pramod Kumar.
Continue,
Prakash. My dear students, it's my privilege to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of this department. It's a privilege to have such an eminent personality among with us, our chairperson, Dr. S. Rahul sir, guiding both the session. So thank you so much, sir. I extend my hearty thanks to Dr. P.K. Das sir for reflecting on the concept of Pratyahara. Sir, very beautifully apprised. Pratyahara is the fifth limb of Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga. Pratyahara consists in withdrawing the sense from their respective eternal object and keeping under the control the mind. So thank you so much, sir, for your innovative talk, sir. Our heartfelt thanks goes to our Kalyani madam. She addressed on Charvak ethics at life at present. Madam is very short time, very beautifully explained that Jaban jibet sukham jibet, runam kruta gruta pibet, basmi bhutesya dehasya punara gamana kruta. Madam is very beautifully explained. Thank you so much, madam, for your innovative and informative talk, sir. It's my honor to offer the gratitude to the participants like Dr. Dhaneshwar sir, Dr. D.M. Prahara sir, Dr. Kodash Chandra Das sir, Dr. Tanuja madam, Dr. Olaka madam, Dr. Sujata Tripathi madam, Dr. Olaka Alok, sorry, Dr. Alok Tanda madam, Dr. Vijay sir, Dr. Lakhman sir, Dr. Arjun sir, Binita madam, Dr. K. Omnarayan sir, Charulata madam, Dr. Puspa madam, Indra madam, Tathur sir, Vijendra sir, Rajkishore sir, and all other who was connecting with us. So thank you so much, sir. I would like to give a special thanks to Dr. Kora sir, who is a person behind this success of this program. So thank you so much, sir. Last but not the least, let me thanks Dr. Pramod sir for recording and telecasting this webinar. So thank you so much again, sir. I thereby sincerely thanks each and every person who heartedly for glorifying this event with your gracious presence. So thank you so much, everyone, sir.
Thanks so much, Prakash, for beautifully proposing vote of thanks. And at last, I offer my gratitude to the chairperson, to the speakers, and to the participants for glorifying both the session. Thanks so much, sir. Now we have to close the meeting. Okay, again, I request you to attend the third day program tomorrow.